regarding the purpose of our creation. Really, the title itself assumes something, that we are, of course, created. There's an assumption in that title which deserves to be explored and considered and discussed. And it requires us to look around our universe, to look at our world, to look at ourselves, and to make some deductions, to reflect and to think carefully. And that is something Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders us in the Quran to do. Many places. In Surah Ali Imran, in verses which are quite famous to you all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said,
إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَآيَاتٍ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ.
Indeed, in the creation of the heavens and the earth, and the alternation of the night and the day are signs for those of understanding. Many passages in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes aspects of His creation in great detail. Why? For us to reflect, for us to look around, and for us to think, and for us to deduce these aspects of Allah's creation. What does it tell us about the Creator? What does it tell us about the Originator? But it deserves to be thought about, because this is the modern age where atheism not only took on a momentum of its own, but it almost became an accepted norm for many people. So it deserves to be thought about and discussed and looked at from different angles. When we look at our universe, if we look on a macro level, if we look at our universe, how the sun or how the earth orbits the sun, the full cycle of the earth to orbit the sun, its precision, 1 year. If we look at the alternation of the night and day, its precision, 24 hours. If we look at the constellation of the stars and how people, human beings, they use them for navigation and travel, you come to one conclusion. And let us at least agree on that conclusion, that within our universe there is order, there is precision, and there is design. Let's not talk about God if you don't want to talk about God, if it is something which is dividing us, or if it's something which people don't agree on. Let's at least reflect on what we can see around us. We don't find chaos. What we find is precision. We find order, and we find design. Everything in its place. Everything moving according to a predetermined orbit. Everything having a purpose. Everything being placed there by design. If we look at the world around us, so if we now were looking at the stars and the planet and the orbits of the planets around the sun and the different galaxies, if we come down lower to the world around us, when we look at the water cycle and how moisture moves from the surface of the ocean across the atmosphere and is taken through the world, providing for people. If we look at the alternation of the night and day, which allows our bodies to rest and work. If we look at the flow of the tide, coming in and then receding every day, again you come to exactly the same conclusion. There is order, things have been placed. There is precision, exactly. And there is design, it's not random. Let's at least agree on that. If you can't agree on anything else, let's at least agree on that. If you look at nature even closer, even the most ardent atheists who study animal behaviors, they look for purpose. If you look at David Attenborough, you know, ardent atheist. You know, they spend months, you know, you might watch a little TV program about some animals in Madagascar or, you know, the polar bears in Antarctica. or the blue whale as it crosses the ocean. You might look at these documentaries, it takes them months to film this. They're sitting there with the high-tech equipment filming every aspect of that animal's behavior. And they're not sitting there thinking, oh, well, he's doing it for no reason, that's just ridiculous. They're looking for purpose, they're looking for patterns. They're trying to understand, why is this animal doing this? And after months of filming and thinking and comparing studies, they deduced that, okay, this animal does this to ward off predators. This animal does this as a mating call. They never turn around and say, oh, this animal's doing this for no reason, it's just a joke. Yeah. No aspect of Allah's creation is without purpose. And even the most ardent atheist recognizes that. If we look to human beings ourselves, aspects of our own being, the complexity of the eye, how light is captured through these receptacles, and how the image is transferred on the brain, and how it actually ends up coming upside down, and how our brains flip it round so we can make sense of what we see. Look at the complexity of that. Look at the precision of that. That's not random. That's not chaos. That's something which is very predetermined. If we look at the ability of the body to repair itself when you get injured, or even more serious, when people suffer brain injuries, and how the brain compensates and takes over functions in other parts to compensate for the parts that have been damaged. What you see is organization. What you see is order. If you think about your tongue, you use it to taste with, right? You also use it to talk with. Where's the switch? Where's the flip? How do you interchange between the two? It just happens naturally. That's not an accident. Intelligent design is behind that. Wisdom is behind that. That's not an accident. If you look at human complexion, right, let's go right down to detail. You look at human beings, and you know the variety of our complexions, our colors, our faces. As soon as any person does something, plastic surgery, changes something, a celebrity, a star, when you look at their face, what do you think? Let's say you don't even know that they've had plastic surgery. When you look, what do you think? What do you think? What do you think? Looks good looking? What do you think? Any ideas? What do you think? Tell me, be honest.
That there's something wrong with their face.
It looks something's wrong, something out of place. Doesn't look right. Okay, people are of different complexions, some people good looking, some people not so good looking, and beauty is in the eye of the beholder anyway. But as soon as people start changing, messing around, it doesn't look right. Okay, I mean, don't do this, but if you Google, you know, plastic surgery, botch ups, yeah? It's laughable. Celebrities, people who are good looking, but they just weren't satisfied and they started to tinker and change. And it just looks wrong. Something is out of place. You can't describe it. What is it about the cheekbones? What is it about? Is it the lips? Is it what? But they were not happy and they changed. You see, order, precision, intelligent design behind every single human being's face, the way it is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran encouraged us to look upon His creation and reflect. In Surah Al-Ghashiyah, a surah which is well known to many of you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبْلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ. Do they not look at the camels, how we created it? أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبْلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ وَإِلَى السَّمَاءِ كَيْفَ رُفِعَتْ وَإِلَى الْجِبَالِ كَيْفَ نُصِبَتْ وَإِلَى الْأَرْضِ كَيْفَ سُطِحَتْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes your vision to different aspects of His creation as examples. أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبْلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ. Do they not look at the camels, how they were created? What do you know about camels? Tell me what you know about camels.
contains water.
Okay, hum contains water. Why does it contain water? Yeah, they can go for long periods without consuming water. Why do they need that? To cross the desert, right? There's no water. That's why they're called Safinatu Sahra, the ships of the desert. They cross the deserts. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala draws your attention to this miracle, this everyday miracle. But also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to have the patience of the camel. Days without water. Not that Allah wants you to go without water. No. Allah wants you to have sabr. And He draws your attention to an aspect of His creation which has so much sabr. A camel. Going for long periods without drinking, crossing the desert. وَإِلَى السَّمَاءِ كَيْفَ رُفِعَتْ. At the sky, how it was raised. Okay? When you look at the sky, okay, how beautiful it is, how lofty it is. If you start shouting at the sky, insulting the sky, swearing at the sky, does it make any difference to the sky? It is aloof. It is above all of this behavior. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to have those qualities like the sky, above, able to overlook people, able to not respond or not need to respond. وَإِلَى الْجِبَالِ كَيْفَ نُصِبَتْ. And at the mountains, how they have been made firm. What do we know about mountains? What do we know? We don't know anything. They're tall, okay. That's interesting you said that. They're tall, right? They have a high peak. Where is the majority of the mass of the mountain?
Below ground.
Underground. Yeah? Treat it like a peg. What you see is only the tip. The majority of the mass of the mountain is below ground, which makes the mountains unshakable, strong, solid, strong foundation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to be like this. Unshakable, solid, can't be pushed around, can't be changed easily, can't be pressured into giving up your religion. وَإِلَى الْأَرْضِ كَيْفَ سُطِحَتْ. And the ground, how we have spread it out. You see, the ground, the earth, the surface, it carries all the people, right? The old, the young, the good, the bad, the ugly, the wretched, the rude, the good-mannered. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you like that, to be able to carry those people, to be able to tolerate those people. And what's the next verse? After mentioning these four aspects of these creation, what's the next verse? Fadakkir. So remind. Fadakkir, so remind. It's a command to give da'wah. And the four examples where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave before of His creation are all qualities you are going to need if you are going to give da'wah. Fadakkir, so remind. You're going to have patience, need patience like the camel. You're going to have to be aloof like the sky, not responding to every rude person that insults you. You're going to have to be solid and strong like the mountains. And you're going to have to be tolerant like the earth which carries all the people. Fadakkir, so remind. Those who give da'wah must have these qualities. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always is reminding people to reflect and look at His creation. And to ponder over His creation. And it's a sad reality actually that, you know, especially people living in big cities, conurbations, they're very detached from nature, the outside world. You know? Many people never seen a sun rise, never seen a sunset. Many people never breathed fresh air. Many people never drank water from a fresh stream, flowing stream. And it has an effect on your character when you are completely detached from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's creation. You know, I remember with a group of practicing brothers, we went to Lake District. You know, some of these guys never, you know, in their 20s, they've never been outside London. You know? And then when they saw the like mountains and like, is this Wales? You know, it's not, it's a problem, right? You know, they don't even know if you're in England or Wales, you know, but like their perception of England is just towns, you know, roads, buildings. So Allah wants us to reflect on His creation, to marvel at His creation, but with a very specific lens, which is to recognize the Creator and to see the attributes of the Creator in His creation. Now there's some interesting quotes that I wanted to mention to you. One was from Dr. Justin Barrett, who's a senior researcher at Oxford University. And he said, "The preponderance of scientific evidence for the past 10 years or so has shown that a lot more seems to be built into the natural development of children's minds than we once thought, including a predisposition to see the natural world as designed and purposeful, and that some kind of intelligent being is behind that purpose." SubhanAllah. Interestingly enough, Stephen Hawking, you know, famous physicist, you know, agnostic or atheist, you know, probably atheist. "The overwhelming impression is one of order. The more we discover about the universe, the more we find that it is governed by rational laws." So let's just agree on that, whether you're Muslim, non-Muslim, whether you're a believer, don't believe. You know what, let's just agree that what we see around the world is remarkable. That it is ordered, that it is precise, and there is an intelligent design behind it. You just can't come to any other conclusion. We don't accept any other conclusion. If we were sitting here in a court case, a murder had taken place, and the defendant, his fingerprints were found at the murder scene, the murder weapon has been found on them, their DNA is on the dead body, end of story, you're guilty. We don't accept or tolerate for that defendant to say, well, it could have been chance. Who knows? You know, there's a possibility, isn't there? Of course, there's always a possibility, an infinitesimal mathematical probability, but we don't take that into consideration in everyday life. We don't accept it. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, very famous incident where Imam Abu Hanifa was very powerful in dialogue. One of the greatest minds in Muslim history. Beautiful fiqh. Beautiful school of thought. Organic in its nature, how it builds. One day he had a dialogue, or planned a dialogue with an atheist. They waited for him to turn up. He never turned up. They're waiting. Time's going past, and finally he arrives. And disappointed, they say, "You know, where were you? We were waiting. We had an appointment." And he makes his famous liner, where he says, "I was coming." It's a rough meaning. "I was coming to the river. The trees chopped themselves down. Wow! And I was so amazed by this. I was watching. They formed themselves into planks and nailed themselves together into a boat. I was so amazed, I jumped on the boat and crossed the river." And they looked at each other, and they said, "That's not possible." And he said, "You want me to believe something even more ridiculous than that? That this entire universe, with all its complexity, with all its beauty, came out of nothing?" And he walked away. So let's just agree that what we see around us is beautiful, and there is order there. Now, my personal reflection is that when people claim to be atheists or claim not to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, What they end up doing is relegating the attributes of Allah to something else. So they talk about nature. Oh, isn't nature beautiful? I mean, what exactly is nature? Why are you talking about nature as if it's a living entity? Why are you referring to nature doing things? Nature is not an intelligent being. You're simply looking at the creation and giving now the creation a consciousness where it's creating itself, making itself, designing itself. And that's just not possible. Or people talk about chance, that everything is just the most remarkable act of chance. Everything came into being by chance. Okay, if everything came into being by chance, does chance continue to manage the universe? Even though it's totally ridiculous, the idea that the universe came into being with all its complexity by chance, then who continues to manage it? It would have come into being and then disintegrated straight away. Who continues to manage it? Who manages these cycles? Who allows the cycle of life to continue? So people simply take the attributes of Allah, of God, and they give it to inanimate objects or concepts. And they never ever manage to escape from the fact that there is intelligent design behind the creation. You see, whenever we see order, we think of the originator. You see an amazing building, a skyscraper, you think of the architect. You see a sculpture, you think of the sculptor. You see a beautiful painting, who do you think of? The artist. You're admiring the originator of all of this. So why, when it comes to the creation itself, the universe, us as human beings, why do you want to divorce that connection? You don't accept it in any other area of your life. You wouldn't accept it in court. You wouldn't accept it in your everyday life. Yet we try to accept this when it comes to the origin and purpose of our creation. So why is it, particularly in the modern phenomena, that atheism has become so prominent? Why is it? It's a question. What do you think? More than before. Any ideas? Yeah?
People don't want to be accountable.
People don't want to be accountable. That's a very good answer. You see, it's not just I believe in God. When you say I believe in God, what naturally comes as a consequence after that? I believe in God. Okay, what's the natural next step? What does God want from me? I must follow. How will He judge me? There are many, many therefores that come after that. So for people who don't want to be accountable in any way and do exactly what they want, the simplest way is to cut the connection with God. And God doesn't exist. Simple as that. Yeah, then I'm not accountable to anyone. I don't have to follow anything because I just simply don't believe He exists. Okay, what are some of the other reasons why atheism has become more prominent in recent times? Any ideas? Yeah.
The spreading of more and more information and more arguments in favor of atheism.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
And in opposition to religion.
Right. It's simply the fact that people are like sheep. They just follow the majority, or the one who's shouting the loudest. So there's no actual intellectual strength behind the argument. It's just so many people are saying it. It's coming through with so many images, advertising, consumerism. So I might as well just follow it along, like everyone else is following it along. It's kind of like your Donald Trump school of thought. Just say it. Say it loud enough. Get as many people to, you know, believe in it, and then it gets a momentum of its own. This guy doesn't care at all about what's true and what's not true. No problem at all. Just make up something. You know, and let's see, yeah, I've got enough money, got enough backing, got enough media outlets. It'll start to develop a momentum of its own. You know? There was a time when he was claiming that, you know, Obama was not born in the US. I mean, the guy's got his birth certificate, explains where he's born. Oh, it doesn't matter, just keep on going. You know? And it's scary how people get into it, they believe in it. And I remember one of his followers being interviewed. You know, intelligent people. Intelligent people. They're not just all kind of, you know, hillbilly rednecks. They're not like that, all of them. And the interviewer was asking him, you know, surely you know what he's saying is not true. And she goes, yeah, I know. It's not true. But I think he's trying to make a point. Yeah. So the truth becomes like completely irrelevant. Whether atheism is true or not becomes completely irrelevant. It gets a momentum of its own. What are some of the other reasons why? Yeah? Because of technology, people are much less in tune. Or let me put it another way. Because of technology, people feel much less in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't rely on the rain. They don't rely on the harvest. You know, they're not so affected by weather. And that sense of relying on Allah slowly is cut away. And also, that technology makes them feel modern. Nobody likes to look old-fashioned, right? And somehow religion seems old-fashioned, technology seems modern, and that technology is coupled with an image that comes with atheism as being, you know, open-minded, intellectual. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said something in Surah Al-Alaq. كَلَّا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطْغَى أَنْ رَآهُ اسْتَغْنَى. Man has gone beyond all limits. Why? Because he considers himself self-sufficient. When human beings consider themselves self-sufficient, that's when they go beyond the limits. That's when they turn away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So a person, a regular person, they might feel not in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're doing their job, they're earning their money, the retail outlets are there, everything they want, they can buy. So what's the need for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? كَلَّا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيْتَغَى أَنْ رَآهُ اسْتَغْنَى. Man has gone beyond all limits because he considers himself self-sufficient. It's the ultimate act of arrogance. I don't need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, the truth of whether he created the world, what the purpose of this world is, that becomes irrelevant. It becomes a casualty. It develops a momentum of its own, this idea, I don't need Allah, he doesn't even exist. But subhanAllah, there's a part of human beings, it's imprinted on their soul to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they will never attain happiness until they believe and turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we look around, let's not get too religious, yeah? Let's keep cool about this. Yeah? When we look around at the creation, at the universe, at the world, when we look and reflect upon our own selves, there's some conclusions which we come to, for sure. That there is a creator. It's simply no other explanation is possible. Any other explanation simply is taking the attributes of the creator and giving it to inanimate objects and concepts. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked a rhetorical question in the Quran. أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ أَمْ خَلَقُوا السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ بَلْ لَا يُوقِنُونَ. Were they created from nothing, or were they themselves the creators? Or did they create the heavens and the earth? No, but they have no firm belief. Come on guys, if you don't believe that Allah exists, then what's the alternative? That you created everything? That nothing created you? And it's a rhetorical question. It doesn't even need an answer. Allah doesn't even include the option of, oh, or Allah created. It's a rhetorical question. There's blaming in it. There's censor. There's only about two or three verses in the Quran like this where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenges the atheists. Only two or three verses. Why do you think that is? Why isn't more of the Quran dedicated to rebutting atheism? A lot of the Quran is simply rebutting associating partners with Allah. But very few verses talking about atheism. Why do you think that is? Yeah.
In times of hardship, everyone returns to Allah.
Good. In times of hardship, everyone turns back to Allah. When they're in that plane. That was a bad example, wasn't it? Okay. Let's go. When they're in that ship. Okay. Yeah, when they're in that ship and the waves are crashing high and the boat is turning from side to side. This folly, which is atheism, goes out of the window. People turn to who they know can help them. They turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know that yourself. Maybe some of you have gone through periods in your life, you don't really know much about Islam. And maybe you harbored some doubts about Allah. I don't know if he exists. Maybe you're agnostic deep down. But when things get difficult, seriously difficult, the doubt all goes away and you just turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What are some of the other reasons why you think the Quran doesn't address atheism much? It does address it, but not much.
Allah wants to guide someone, no one can misguide him.
Okay.
If he wants to guide someone,
no yeah. That's a good answer.
It's a desire from Allah. If he wants to guide someone, then if he's atheist, then he can guide him.
So Allah himself can guide people? Okay, but that doesn't. Why doesn't more of the Quran talk about atheism? Yes?
Because they don't have much of a foundation to stand on. Yeah. Only two or three arguments.
Yeah. One way is it's a form of dismissing. Allah is dismissing the nonsense. It's not even worth addressing. But subhanAllah, one of the facts which you would have noticed that human beings by and large have always believed in Allah in one form or another. They have always believed in God. Historically. Cultures, civilizations. It's only isolated pockets that have denied Allah's existence completely. And we're currently in a phase which is probably the only period in human history where en masse people have started to disbelieve in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the Quran doesn't address it much at all because by and large people throughout history have always believed in Allah. Always believed in God. The Quraysh used to believe in Allah. They used to call him Allah. When the Prophet ﷺ at the Battle of Badr was raising his hands, begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for victory and saying, "Oh Allah, if this group of believers is wiped out, you will not be worshipped on the earth." What do you think the Quraysh were doing on the other side? What were they doing? Anybody know?
Beseeching to the same God.
They were also making dua, the same God. Abu Jahl raised his hands. Quraysh, leader of Quraysh, Fir'aun of this ummah, the tyrant who fought the Prophet ﷺ, he raised his hands and he said, "Oh Allah, oh Allah," he made dua to Allah. Can you believe that? He made dua to Allah to defeat the Prophet ﷺ. It's part of your nature. He said, "Oh Allah, give victory to whoever is better for the unity of the Arabs and defeat whoever came with something new." And Allah answered his dua. The Prophet ﷺ was better for the unity of the Arabs. And the Prophet ﷺ, and it was the Quraysh who came with something new, this form of paganism. So human beings throughout history have believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is imprinted on your soul. It is something you cannot get rid of. However much you hate God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, however much religion repulses you, however much you think religion has caused wars and conflict, it is imprinted on your soul to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Surah Al-A'raf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He took out all the souls, all the progeny of Adam. And what question did he ask? All of them, including me, you, everyone, next man outside, atheist, everyone. He asked the same question. What was the question?
Am I your Lord?
Am I your Lord? Alastu bi Rabbikum? Am I not your Lord? And everyone answered, all of us, Bala. Yes, of course you are. From that moment, it is imprinted on your soul to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to believe in God. Wherever you are in this world, there will be a strong impulse within you to believe in God. That's when people say, oh, what about if someone's in the Amazon and he's, you know, walking around with that Tarzan thing on, you know, with his spear, and you know, no access to knowledge. Still imprinted on their soul is to believe in God, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Does anybody know the term in Arabic used for this natural belief? Fitra, the natural disposition which every human being is created with. It's like a compass, a moral compass, which guides the person to make the correct decisions. In Surah Ash-Shams, which you will know, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا جَلَّاهَا. This is the part of the Quran which contains the most oaths in one surah. Something like 13 oaths. What's the conclusion of the oaths? You know, in Arabic, when you make an oath, Wallahi, you must finish it with a, you know, something you're going to do or some piece of information. So what is the conclusion of these 13 or so oaths in Surah Shams? وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا جَلَّاهَا وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَاهَا. Allah is again taking oaths by His creation, by the sun and its forenoon, by the moon, so many aspects of His creation. And what is the conclusion? What is the punchline here? قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. Successful is indeed he who purifies it. But before that, فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. Inspired it to good and to evil. This is the fitrah. This is the natural disposition. This is what's been imprinted on your soul. You recognize automatically that God exists. That you recognize basic morals. It's wrong to steal. It's wrong to murder. It's good to be good, kind to your parents. It's that moral compass within you which guides you. And however much you hate religion or the concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creating you, bringing you back to life, it continues to guide you in your life. That's why the word kufr, what does kufr linguistically mean? Kufr means disbelief, right? What does it linguistically mean? To cover something up. So you got this belief in you. It's very powerful. It's trying to guide you. And you cover it up. You suppress it. You intoxicate yourself, not just in alcohol, but in life itself, to try and suppress it and to bring it down. You then try and seek fulfillment in other things. What kind of things do people seek fulfillment in?
Music.
Drugs, alcohol, fame. Could be good things, giving a lot of charity. But they try and intoxicate themselves and seek fulfillment in other things. But that part of their soul which is looking to recognize Allah is unsatisfied. It's still looking to recognize Allah. It's still looking to worship Allah and submit to Allah alone. So here you are, you've got this throbbing belief in you, trying to guide you. And you're trying to look for fame, you're trying to look for money, alcohol, relationships. And none of it is fulfilling this part of your soul. So what ends up happening? What ends up happening?
Depression.
Feelings of unfulfillment. Suicide. Because there's a part of your soul which will not be satisfied until it recognizes and submits to its creator. So whether we look at the natural world around us, whether we look at human beings, whether we look at our very essence and nature, it all points to the same conclusion. It points to a conclusion that there is a creator and that he is one and unique. He is one and unique. It's something we rebel and reject straight away. Oh, different gods. What, so which God created this world and which God created the universe? And if that was the case, as the Quran says, the gods would compete with each other. Any kind of anthology, any kind of belief system which has multiple gods in it, what do the gods end up doing? Fighting, yeah? Zeus fighting against this one. They're vying for control over this world. If you look at the kind of, you know, the Hindu myths, the different gods, Brahman fighting against Shiva, and, you know, everyone's getting involved now. Everyone's getting their back up. You know, that's what happens, isn't it? If we try and go down this line of belief in different gods, each one will vie for supremacy. No, it is natural to believe in one unique God. Perfection means unique. We don't talk about many things being perfect. One is perfect. We can deduce he's compassionate, he's merciful. Look how a mother who gives birth, how she cares for that child. For I don't know how this child, what does it do? Just screams, demands milk, is defecating itself, urinating itself, screaming in the night. There's no reason to look after this baby. Just kick it out. But look at the compassion of the mother, especially the mother. After this parasite has been taking from her for 9 months, comes out born and is even worse. But look at the compassion of the mother. This mercy, it comes from somewhere. It comes from Allah. We learn that Allah is a merciful God. He placed mercy in His creation. Look how animals treat their young. This is a merciful God. This is a compassionate God. He is just, we learn from the creation. Okay? Let's say you see a couple of little kids. It's really fascinating looking at children. See a couple of little kids playing, yeah? One's playing with this toy, one's playing with this toy. This kid snatches the other kid's toy. What happens? Starts crying. It's not fair. Demanding justice. How did that child from such a early age learn about a concept called justice? About fairness? Why didn't that child just recognize he snatched it? Okay, fair enough. That's life, you know? No, the child demands, no, it's wrong. It starts crying. It can't even speak, but it starts crying. And then the parent works out, oh, the other one took the toy, isn't it? Yeah, the strong sense of justice which comes out from Allah, from the origin. That Allah is just. And that sense of justice is so powerful, it's transcendent. You know, you see parents, sometimes their children are murdered, daughters are murdered. Their rage, their sense of justice is so strong. It goes beyond anything that this world can satisfy. It goes beyond the court, whether the person is caught or not. They're demanding something more than that. We are intrinsically programmed to believe in something like the Day of Judgment. Something where all of the rights, or all of the wrongs will be right, made right. Everything will be balanced. So we learn about this Creator, He is one, He is unique, He is perfect. Just by reflecting, we learn He's compassionate, He's merciful. He's just. And from looking at the creation and the design and the precision, we learn He's all-knowing, all-wise. All of this before we even open the Qur'an. Just by reflecting on His creation, as Allah ordered us in the Qur'an to do so. Human beings throughout history have always believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Always believed in a God. But their belief systems have become confused and corrupted. Their pure relationship with Allah has become polluted. Why? Because their sense of disgust with themselves. We can't turn to God. Look at what we've done. Ah, you need to turn to this saint, you see. Or you need to go to this priest, confess your sins. The priest is the middleman between you and God. And in every false religion you find middlemen. People who claim to be intermediaries between you and Allah. Because they cannot face up to Allah for that pure relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It could be self-disgust with what they have committed. But more likely, they don't want that direct relationship with Allah. They don't want to think about Allah. They don't want to feel accountable to Allah. They don't want to feel that sense of guilt and shame. So it's much easier to put a middleman in between, a normal human being himself, so sinful. And that person will take care of things, just go to him, give him a donation, confess to him. And every religion, not Christianity alone, every religion has those middlemen. But Islam demands that pure relationship with one creator and one sustainer. Let's think about, in the context of this, da'wah. When you think deeply about this, you realize da'wah is not a major intellectual exercise. There is a forum for intellectual debate. You know, you find the atheist debating and the a Muslim debating. There's a forum for that, particularly with people who are high profile. But this was not the da'wah largely of the Quran and the Prophet. Not really. Remember what we said, it's imprinted on every person's heart to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No person has a major intellectual confusion about this. Really, they don't. So sometimes in our da'wah we can be very kind of very intellectual and trying to use ration and logic to prove the existence of Allah, which is fine, nothing wrong with that. Except you're barking up the wrong tree. That's not the problem. But no one really in the world has a major intellectual confusion about God's existence. What is the real problem? What is the real problem? Why don't they believe in God, or why do they claim not to believe in God's existence? Because if we're going to be successful with da'wah, we need to know what the root of the problem is. What do you think? We've kind of discussed it slightly already. What is the problem?
Modern science.
Modern science?
Okay. Attempting to contradict what you can't work.
But I mean, we've just taken quite a scientific approach. We've looked around us, the world, the universe, ourselves. We came to one conclusion. I don't think science is the problem.
Ideology.
Ideology? Okay. What do you mean by that?
The belief that their forefathers believed in.
Okay, that's a good point you've made. Wanting to be loyal to their forefathers' ideology. The main problem is desires. Simple as that. People are atheists because they want to follow their desires. They don't want to start believing in a God that restricts you, that says this is not allowed and that is allowed. You have to do this, you have to pray, you'll be brought back to life and you will answer for you. Who needs that? Let me follow my desires, let me do what I want. So despite having this strong innate belief in God, they'd rather suppress it and continue being intoxicated in their desires. The main problem is desires. That should change your style of da'wah a little bit. Doesn't need to be high-flown intellectual always. Because the person already deep down knows. So in the Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks to the Prophet, he doesn't order the Prophet to engage in a long debate. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the Prophet, فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرْ. Remind, because you are only a reminder. In the Quran, da'wah is described as reminding. That's it, reminding. What does that imply? If you describe da'wah as reminding, what does that imply?
They already know it.
They already know it. Allah is reassuring you. What you are going to talk to that person about, that person knows it almost as good as you already. You know when you remind someone about healthy eating, right? Let me tell you about the benefits of fruit and veg. No. Just need to remind the person, right? Because they already know. The person already understands basically who is Allah, who is God. Your job is to remind them and to be a little bit assertive about that. If you be a bit too airy-fairy, then it's not powerful enough to shake them away from what they were engrossed in. Need to be a little bit assertive. and understand that that person already understands, is already pre-programmed to believe in what you believe. It's just you made the moral choice to follow your instinct and your heart. That person did not make that moral choice for various reasons. Could be, you know, desires. It could be following their forefathers. Could be ideology they want to follow. Could be feeling of, you know, self-disgust, not wanting to face up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many, many reasons. They should give you a sense of confidence that what you're doing is not some confusing, I'm going to have to convince this person, I'm going to have to come up with some really big argument that's just going to make blow their mind away, wow. No, you're just going to have to remind them about what they already know. What they already know. And sometimes it just boils down to arrogance. What, you? I mean, you. You're going to tell me now what the purpose of life is. Have you seen you? You know what I mean? You know, look at you guys. Look at the way you dress. Look at the way how your communities are. Look at the problems you cause around the world. And you're now going to tell me about the purpose of life. Have you any idea about my past, my history? About my people, what they've achieved? So it often boils down to simple arrogance. So we're going to end with an example from the Quran about da'wah and about convincing people about the purpose of their creation. And it's really quite a fascinating example, and it's an example I always use and talk about a lot, which is when Musa came to Fir'aun. Now set the scene, there has never really been a greater atheist than the Pharaoh. Because he wasn't just an atheist, he came up with the idea, I am God. Never mind, I don't believe in God, I am the God. أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. I am your Lord, the Most High, he said in the Quran. And this was not some kind of crazy belief he was just peddling along. This was the main state religion. If you've ever seen pictures of ancient Egypt and the temples of Abu Simbel, you might have seen it's a huge temple built into the mountainside. I don't know how they built a temple in a mountainside. You know, we think of people in the past were backward and they just got like an axe and that's it, and they're trying to build stuff. I mean, this is very advanced civilization. They built into a mountain. Not just like a tunnel like we can do. They built palaces into the mountains. And he has a temple called the Temple of Abu Simbel. This is Ramesses II, who's most likely the Pharaoh of Musa. And in front he has four colossal statues. Of who? Of who?
Himself.
His worship of himself became so engrossed, he built these huge monuments to himself, where he has four, not one, four statues of himself. And in the religion of that, the people of that time, if you read the inscriptions, there are paintings of him praying to who? To himself. So he's praying, and the one who's standing and being prayed to is himself as well. So he was so into this. And the people were not allowed to mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to mention God. They had to believe this man is a living God. And we know this from the hadith, where the lady who used to comb the hair of the daughters of Pharaoh, she once dropped the comb, and she said, Bismillah. And the daughter of Pharaoh, this authentic hadith, said, do you mean my father? And she said, no, I mean Allah. And when this was reported to the Pharaoh, he brought a cauldron of oil and threw her and her children into that cauldron of oil, just for mentioning the name of Allah. So imagine a society where there is one man who has complete control, who believes he is Allah, who claims he believes he is Allah, and everyone cannot even mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Musa came to this man. And what did Musa say to this man? Did he sit him down, look, you know, we need to have a chat. You know this belief you've got, I've got to be honest, you know. if we talk about the moon and the stars, you know, is this really plausible what you're saying about you being a god? Can we just talk about this? What did Musa say to him? The very first time he walks into his palace and stands in front of him, and Pharaoh is arrogant, reclining on his throne. What's this guy going to say to me? he has a speech impediment. What is he going to say to me? What is the first thing Musa says? Anybody?
I have been sent by your Lord.
Exactly. Inna Rasula Rabbik. We are the messengers of your Lord. He doesn't even mess around convincing him. Let's talk about Allah's existence. He takes it for granted. Let's not mess around. Let's not beat around the bush here. We are the messengers of your Lord. Which means implicitly, you know and I know that there is a creator. And that he sends messengers. And he has spoken to humanity through his messengers and through his messages. SubhanAllah, and the Pharaoh is flummoxed. What does Pharaoh say in return? فَمَنْ رَبُّكُمَا يَا مُوسَىٰ. So who is your Lord, O Moses? Like a sarcastic question. And then Musa responds, describing how Allah creates, how He sustains. And then Pharaoh is unable to keep up with the dialogue. He then says, فَمَا بَالُ الْقُرُونِ الْأُولَىٰ. And what about the past nations? You know how people ask, what about the people in the Amazon? What about these people? It's a distraction tactic. Musa just dismisses that and keeps on talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you talk about God, you will notice people want to change the subject. They can't keep up. They can't sustain the dialogue. Okay, they might want to talk about women's rights. They might want to talk about jihad. They might want to talk about justice. Right, why don't we talk about God? And they just can't go very far with that. So keep focused on your main goal here and your main aim, which is to talk about Allah. If you want to talk about women in Islam, you know, and have a dialogue, but as long as that dialogue leads back to belief in God, belief in Allah. If you want to talk about, you know, social justice, fine, but let's take the conversation back to belief in Allah. And don't allow yourself to be distracted. And have the confidence in yourself. Have the confidence in yourself that you're following the most natural way of life. Something that is intrinsic to you. Something you were born with. And something you share with every other human being. Never mind every other human being. All of creation is making tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The birds, the animals, the mountains, the skies, they're all making tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you might feel like a little minority here. You're not the minority, you're the majority. You're the overwhelming majority. There's just a few guys running around saying, we don't believe in God. There's no God. It's like specks running around saying this. The entire creation, the entire globe is turning, making tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why in the Quran, when Allah speaks about tasbih, Allah speaks about tasbih, سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى, as an order. سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى. In the past tense, in the future tense, in all forms. Because everything in the world is resounding with the tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the glorification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All human beings understand this. There's just a few guys running around. No, don't agree. I don't accept it. And that's why you understand the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when He consigns people in the hereafter. Not only did they reject the signs around them, what they could see with their eyes, not only did they reject people around them who reminded them, but they suppressed their own nature and suffocated it and crushed it just to follow these desires. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.